Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome. This is Ron Seaver calling in from the National Sports Forum. I'm the president and founder of the forum, and we wanted to welcome you all for our NSF monthly webinar. We're delighted to have you here. The topic this month, and we haven't really covered sponsorship in a while, but this month our topic is building an ideal sponsorship, tips for success in the sponsorship process. Before we get started, I just want to say a special thank you to looking over the list. We have quite a turnout today. About 175 folks are on the call today. So we're delighted, and we want to thank you all for being there and give a very special shout out to those of you. I saw the list, and a lot of you were with us last month when we had the forum. We put the forum on in this year. We were spotlighting Minneapolis, St. Paul. So we were up in the Twin Cities and just had an absolutely outstanding time, including all three of our panelists today that were there and were working very hard on the forum. And these are three terrific experts in the field of sponsorship. So we want to welcome you. For those of you who are new to the call, welcome. Great way to get introduced to the National Sports Forum. We do this on a periodic basis where we cover topics anywhere from ticket sales to sponsorship today, marketing, business development, social media, advertising. We try to talk on all of the revenue-generating topics that impact all of us in our business. And looking at the roster of people that are on the call, we've got agencies, we have got sponsors, we have got international flavor. I saw that we have some world rugby on the call. We have a lot of folks in from Canada. So we're delighted to have you with us. This is a terrific topic, and certainly we all know that sponsorships are an integral part of how we run our operations. We can't do it without it. And so what we wanted to do today is bring in three experts to kind of take the process of sponsorship into three different pieces, if you would. Chad Siegler, who is going to start us off, he's going to be literally talking and focusing a lot on the prospecting of the sponsor. Next up, Angelina Lawton, the CEO and founder of Sports Digita. She's going to be helping us and talking a lot about the selling process of the sponsor. Now that you've located it, what are some tips and insights to help sell the sponsor? And then Dan Magala, a longtime forumite and certainly a very close friend of ours, is going to be talking about the activation of the sponsorship and some of the programs that they have done, very unique. All three of these, I think the common theme through all three of these individuals is outside the box thinking. So trust me, you guys are in for a great time. I hope you have a pad of paper. Take lots of notes. At the end, now these calls, these webinars, as always, are recorded. And in the next day or two, you're going to be receiving a link to go back in. So if there's anything in here that you missed or you wanted other people to hear, you can click on the link that Albie sends you, or you can certainly always go to our website and pull down the link on webinars, and you can see any of our past webinars. So be on the lookout for that. Hopefully, if you have any questions, we have a box you can see on your screen here that you can type your question in, and given time, we will run it by. But if we don't get a chance to hit your question today, then we'll definitely tell us who you want to aim it towards, and we'll get them your question, and they can follow up with you. So with that said, and without further ado, I want to lead us off here with Chad Siegler, the Vice President of Business Development for NASCAR. A lot of you who are familiar with the forum, you certainly know Chad. Chad and Dan are both steering committee members of the forum, and Angelina is a sponsor. So these are people, there are three groups that are very well introduced to the forum family. And Chad, as you know, his current role, he oversees the business strategy and revenue generation for all of NASCAR, leading a sales force. He has representatives in New York, certainly in Charlotte, where he is today, Daytona, and Los Angeles. His last year has been crazy because he's played a critical role in the securing of a new official entitlement partner for the NASCAR circuit, which he's going to be talking about a little bit here. So without further ado, really focusing on prospecting, big game hunting. That was a heck of a sponsorship that he had here, and he brought along a lot of slides to take us through. So Chad, if I may, I'm going to turn the floor over to you and tell us about the landing of Monster and what that's meant and the upcoming direction for NASCAR.
Absolutely. Well, Ron, thank you for the generous introduction, and thank you for everyone that's joined the panel today and joined the webinar. And as Ron said, I oversee our business development team based out of Charlotte, representatives in all the states that he mentioned, Florida, Daytona Beach, LA, and New York. And we are charged daily with just being the group that is out there and in charge of going to find revenue for NASCAR and telling the story of NASCAR and why it's a valuable property for people to be a part of. And the last 2 years specifically, we have spent on an extensive search for our entitlement series partner, so which is Monster Energy. And anyone that is familiar with the sport knows the importance of sponsorship. For those that may not live in NASCAR or be as familiar with NASCAR, we're a sport very unlike others in the sense that sponsorship plays a very critical role in the day-to-day survival of our race teams and our sanctioning body and all of the ecosystem. So what I decided to do today is really, there's a lot of slides, but we're going to try to go through those quickly. I'm not going to talk about those necessarily slide by slide, but really talk about how we go out and tell the story of NASCAR. We never go in to any meetings with the attempt to just go in and sell someone something. We go in to try to educate them on the sport as a whole. And really for us, it's about finding the right partner that helps us grow the sport. So as Ron, as you were mentioning, when you look at the Monster example, when we were in the market for the last, 18 months of looking for that partnership, we kind of went to the market knowing that we were going to be looking for one of three people. You obviously have your tier one blue chip brands that everyone knows and sees in sports sponsorship on a daily basis. That we knew that was an area for us to look at. Another area we put a lot of focus on was the international platform. We tell people, if you're an international company and you're looking to grow your footprint in the United States, there's not a more Americana sport than NASCAR to be a part of. A perfect example, someone like Toyota that came in and had a lot of success in our sport. And then the third was just a challenger brand that could help us grow our sport in specific areas. And we are a sport that has been looking to get younger, been looking to reach that millennial audience. So to have a sponsor that could come in and we could, instead of the sponsor doing all the lifting or us doing the lifting, it was a combination. And when you look at the energy category and a brand like Monster, it was just a natural fit for us. It checks all those boxes. And also, it's a lifestyle brand. We tell people we're not necessarily a sport. We're a lifestyle. So that's kind of the background on how we kind of got where we did with Monster. Albie, if you want to go to the next slide, I'll try to kind of breeze through how we go in and educate people on the sport. And this is just what I was saying earlier. We like to tell people, our sport starts on a Wednesday or Thursday. It's a fan base that travels, 60% of the fans travel over 300 miles to come to an event. So as we talk to sponsors and partners and try to find the right partner, we try to not find someone that's just looking for branding or just looking for activation. It's who wants to truly engage themselves in this lifestyle of this fan and become part of the fabric of the fan. As we tell that story, we tell people, you wouldn't go buy, Ron and the teams in San Diego, you wouldn't go buy a Padres jersey if it had a logo on it, because that's not authentic to who they do. Vice versa, people buy our product because of the logo, because the logo and the sponsorship is organic to what we do. Feel free to move ahead, Albie, second, next slide. This is just a quick landscape. I won't stay on it long. People think of us on what they see on a Sunday. But what we tell people is we have over 1,200 events in 30 different states and also in Canada, Mexico, and Europe where we're racing on a regular basis. And the reason we tell people that, it's not just about what you see on Sunday, which is this massive number of fans, but if you want to get ingrained in a sport, we have everything from 150,000 fans or 100,000 fans like we'll have in California this weekend down to 5,000 fans in a small town in the Midwest of the United States. So it's a perfect way, again, it's all about ingraining people and finding brands that want to ingrain in Americana. Next slide. Again, we can go to the next. This is just another landscape of where we're at. Go to the next slide, Albie. What's new for 17? We always want to tell the story and find people and give them the feel for what we're doing. So this is just a little of education of what we're doing, how we're kind of evolving the sport. Always looking for brands that are also in the process of evolving. That's, a statement that we're telling people right now is that even if you know NASCAR, if you haven't been around it in the last 2 years, you haven't seen us, because we truly have changed the sport and the way we're going to market with the sport. Next slide. Power of NASCAR. These are the couple of slides where we really talk about and we tell people, we are the number one sport in brand loyalty. This is about what we spoke about earlier. Our fans respond and consume product and use product based on it being associated with our sport. Number two sport on television. People maybe know that. Some people probably don't. Over nearly 5.5 million people a weekend are tuning in to watch on television, only second behind the NFL. Number one spectator sport. When you look at average fans, we're going to have 100,000 to 105,000 people 36 weekends a year. And the economic impact when we come to a community, 100 to 200 million in the local economy with 10-month season. So again, as we're looking for brands, it's not all about selling them on why NASCAR, but it's about us finding the right brands that fit that and have those same growth patterns and goals. The fan base demographic, you know, just sort of shows you how we map out. Probably the big surprise there is that bottom right corner. I think if I asked most people on this call, name the top five NASCAR markets, LA, New York, Chicago, Dallas, would probably surprise people. Next slide, Albie. This is a big slide that is important for us. When we talked about Monster and how they're changing, we're trying to tell that story of the changing landscape of NASCAR. So when you look at new fans that have came to the sport in the last 3 years, over almost 60% of them are female, 42% are between the ages of 18 and 34, and 36% of them are multicultural. And that's a big push for us. We feel like as a sport, we're not going to be where we need to be until our fan base numbers match the U.S. population numbers. Next slide, Albie. Insights. At the end of the day, I'm not going to go line by line on this, but at the end of the day, we have fans that are super avid to who we are. They're loyal ambassadors. They go out and tell the story for us of why to be a part of NASCAR, and it's this one big community that comes together with a shared common cause, a common goal. That loyal ambassador thing is really big for us, because what we tell people, when you become and when you want to be a part of NASCAR, you're not just getting our drivers, you're not just getting us as a sanctioning body, you're getting this massive fan base of 60 to 80 million people that are going to go out and tell the story of your brand, and they're going to wear your brand proudly on their clothes and on their chest. Next slide. Again, I won't go through this too deep, but it just talks about, again, the quality of the fan, the fans that tell you they're going to purchase stuff because they're part of the sport. Sponsor consideration and how we rank with sponsor loyalty. Go ahead, Albie. And I'll remind everyone, this deck we'll make available so anyone on the panel today can, or on the webinar, will be able to go back and review it. This is an important one for us, though. In today's world of sports marketing, there's this constant battle between television ratings and attendance. Within our building, consumption is the buzzword. So it's not about who's watching on television, who's watching on their iPad. It's about how many people are watching and how are they watching. So we break it out like this. We track on a regular basis who's watching on television, who's consuming through through digital, and who's engaging in social. Tell people all the time, we recognize television is very important. Television ratings are what we're all judged on. But is that person watching on television any less valuable than the person that's consuming on their iPad? I would argue they're not. I would say the person on the iPad is probably even more valuable because they're super engaged in interaction. Go ahead to the next slide, Albie, feel free. Other thing we tell the story on, we're prospecting. It's easy, in my opinion, for people to really get greedy and selfish when sponsorship dollars are there. Anyone that's on this call that's in the sales side is going to live in that world where you want to get your money and you want to get as much of it as you can. But for us, we feel it's important that you educate a brand on how to do it right. For us, we talk about a four-legged stool. The people that had the most success in our sport are people that have a relationship with NASCAR, a relationship with the team and driver, a relationship with the track, and then obviously a media component. And it's sort of they all work together. You may not have to have all four of these, but you need to have some of them. And the next couple of slides, Abby, we'll go through quick. These are just sort of some samples of things that we include in our official partnerships, and then I can talk a little bit more of just about how, again, like as Ron was talking about, how we do, how we look and how we go to market. Our list of partners, feel free to jump ahead, Albie. Our marketing calendar of how we go to market, feel free to keep going. Just some of the IP rights that we build into our programs that people can use in their sweepstakes, not just the NASCAR logo, but we have a military program, we have a green platform, and then some of our promotional platforms, everything ranging from our All-Star event to our playoffs, our Champions Week, things like that. We can go through, this is a Fuel, a B2B video, the next couple slides, Albie, so it's really a longer video. And then our B2B. At the end of the day, we talked about this active, engaged fan base. That and the customer, that's a big networking interaction, how to drive business. At the end of the day, we want a monster to do business with Ford. So we want all of those Ford dealerships in America to have monster energy machines in their stores. That's how we want to help drive business back and forth. Go ahead. And then the last few, Abby, we can slide through these slides, and I'll touch base just on some highlights for us. The hospitality elements we bring in, build into our platforms. Next slide.
I think that's the last slide, Chad.
Is that it? Okay, no, that's perfect timing. So here's what I would tell you, that we have really taken a step back, and we've, you know, knock on wood, had the luxury of enjoying a successful sales year this year. In addition to Monster, we are on the verge of getting ready to announce our 8th new partner since January 1st, with a couple more coming, which is really important for us. Shows continued growth in the sport. But what we've really been focusing on is, from a prospecting side, and what we're challenging our team with, it's not about just going where everyone else is fishing. It's easy to identify what we see at every venue and every property. We've really been trying to take advantage and look and see where are there unique opportunities for us to bring partners on board where we can leverage those relationships, whether it's a relationship with, you know, we just announced a program with a hotel booking agency. That's important for us because we have a sport that is traveling 36 weekends a year. We've done a program with NetJets. Outside of golf, we probably have the most private aviation with our athletes happening every weekend. So for us, a big challenge we're doing, and I tell people from a prospecting side, is to just think differently. You know, if you're on here from a sales side, if you haven't made best friends with your CFO in your company, I think you're making a huge mistake. You know, for us, we're going to our CFO and asking them, give us a list of the 100 vendors that we're spending the most money with as NASCAR. Because if we're spending money with someone, we should figure out how do we leverage that and turn that into an official partnership or savings. So thinking out of the box is the ultimate theme for us on and telling the NASCAR story and finding the new partners right now. So that's kind of I promise, Ron, I'd keep it to probably 10, 12 minutes. So I try to go top line on there, but I would be happy to answer any questions or anything specifically.
No, well, let me ask you a question. This is awesome, and certainly the overview is massive of NASCAR. I was, like you said in your slides, I was amazed at the top 5 markets. I was like, oh, my God. But obviously a big topic for you this past year was finding the new entitlement rights. And our topic today is tips for success in the sponsorship process. Just as you look back on bringing NASCAR and Monster together, and you know, I've known you obviously for several years, and we talked a lot offline, the work that went into building something from the planning process all the way to the presentation process, for any of our members who are listening online today that are in the market for finding major sponsors, big game hunting, entitlement sponsors, any tips or insights on the process that you just went through that you could pass along?
Yeah, no, that's a great question, Ron. I think there's a couple things. You know, and it's outside the standard, you know, numbers game, because that big game hunting, when you're looking for the naming rights to a stadium, or to, in our situation, when we were talking about an entitlement deal and you're talking about a, you know, a massive price tag, it's not just about the numbers game, because quite honestly, we knew going in there was a limited amount of people in the United States domestically that could even afford this program. So there's a couple things I think you have to be prepared for. One, and this sounds naive to say, you can't be scared to ask for that money. You have to, and if you're going to ask for that money, you have to be comfortable telling your story and making sure your story will deliver against their needs. Number two, you have to put yourself in the shoes of the person on the other side. You know, 7, 8, 9, 10 years ago when we did our deal with Sprint, every company in America had a VP of sports marketing. Though there's very few companies left that have a head of sports marketing. The dollars are being scrutinized even more. So when you go to ask for that big number, you have to remember that's going to go to a board of directors. And for the 10 board of directors members, it only takes one of them to sort of blackball that program. So I think making sure you have the ability to customize a program and deliver against what that program is. You know, and when I look at our Monster program, Ron, it is almost 180 degrees opposite of how Sprint and Nextel activated against us. And we learned that very quick, that what one company did 7, 8, 9 years ago wasn't relevant anymore. So we had to be able to go in and be feel comfortable telling the story of why our fan base will respond to a sponsor, but be flexible enough to customize the need to what, you know, the partner needed. And honestly, customize that yearly. The days of someone buying an asset and just saying, I'm going to keep this asset the same for 10 years are over. You know, you got to be flexible and be willing to move that, you know, year to year and change your assets.
No, thank you. Thank you very much, Chad. I really appreciate it. You know, it's true. We could probably do an entire webinar just on the pursuit of Monster and how that came together and how you're integrating it. But give everybody just a little taste of it here. And to the first leg that we're talking about, prospecting the sponsor, really very few that are better at it than Chad. So our thanks to Chad Siegler for that. And when it comes to creating a tool and tools to help us in the pursuit of our sponsorship, we've always got to keep one eye firmly on technology and new technology. And our next speaker is somebody who is near and dear to the forum. In fact, she just attended her fifth, I want to say it was her fifth forum. So I've had the pleasure to watch her company absolutely really blow up out there to where it was beginning to now well over 300 clients. Helping companies like NASCAR, I mean, Chad would be the first to tell you, but in the prospect of selling the sponsor, is the founder and CEO, Angelina Lawton from Sports Digita, who, you know, founded this company to help professionals, collegiate sports teams create winning sales presentations with a product she's going to talk about a little bit. At least we're going to make her talk about Digideck, which is a terrific, terrific product and used by organizations like the Yankees, the Vikings, Mets. I just told you about NASCAR. We're bringing the forum down to the Dallas community of Frisco next year, and I'm happy to say that Angelina, Sports Digita, handles both the Dallas Stars as well as the Dallas Cowboys. And they're a proud sponsor of Selling It, talking about ideas outside of the box. And if I can put in a shameless plug here, for those of you who are new to the forum, we have a biweekly e-zine that costs nothing. You just have to sign up for it. I think we have well over 5,000 subscribers to it. We've been doing it now for probably about 14 years. And it's called Selling It, and it's proudly sponsored by Sports Digita because they do believe in going outside the box and profiling different programs, different products, new technologies that are helping us all here to do our job. So we've been invited and asked Angelina to come on and talk a little bit about what they're doing at Sports Digita and how that's helping us in the sponsorship sales process. So welcome, Angelina. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Ron. I appreciate that. Chad, great overview of that fantastic new partnership. Obviously, you guys have so many great stories to tell. So as partners, super excited. Just touching on that whole NASCAR experience, though, truly one of my probably top experience, maybe even my number one, just experiencing a race and actually being there is so different than being on TV. I mean, it is just so engaging. So just great to see that all come together for you guys. So I wanted to, you're welcome. So as far as kind of transitioning into our Digideck, we're going to use the Digideck today for our presentation. We're going to just introduce a little bit about who we are. As mentioned, we partner with over 300 teams. We're working with now in the NCAA, NHL, MLB, all of the five major leagues. Here just is a kind of little sampling about who we do work with on the pro side, and then just most recently signed our licensing deal with Learfield Sports. We're very excited about that. That brings on about 128 new collegiate properties and super exciting, obviously, right now with this Sweet 16 coming up this weekend. I'm going to kind of touch on and give a little bit about the landscape and as far as the trends that we're seeing, because we are privy to so many teams and what they're doing and the activations and the partnerships. Just kind of seeing together as a group, what are we seeing? Some of these things I know you've probably heard before, but other, you know, we want to kind of drill down what they actually mean to us and what we're seeing. So I'm going to just start a little bit with the digital transformation on what's happening. So as you know, everything is going digital these days. It's really all about the digital footprint within the franchise and how they're going to bring everything from traditional to the digital, the ecosystem of the web. We feel that as far as digital, it is really needing to progress, and teams are needing to adapt that through all their partnerships and activations. We were just at a conference, and this is one of the slides that we thought was so interesting, that if we're not adapting and we're not moving through with the technology, we feel like, you know, people are falling behind. So when we go into an organization, we're always kind of going down two paths. It's whether we are talking to a team that is progressive or wanting to get progressive, and that definitely, you know, it can go both ways on how we actually guide them through that whole process of their sales presentations. One thing, you know, as far as the digital disruption, which is accelerating, is just we're trying to really say do not be afraid of technology. We need to make sure that we're always providing all assets and helping them kind of bring it all to life. We feel that, you know, really if a team does not, we're trying to have them adapt. You know, we're thinking really by the end of 2017, two-thirds of the CEOs of Global 2000 companies will have digital transformation really at the center of their corporate strategy. So we're really trying to lay that groundwork and that mentality of keeping your digital footprint always at the top of mind. So I always like to give an example here. We work with some progressive teams, some traditional teams, but the ones that we find, like I'm always bringing up the Lakers as a great example. We work with Blaine Skinner there. And he is someone that has worked at the Lakers for 35 years, but always trying to push the envelope on how to do things better and really adapting to technology. And so I always like to use that example because that was someone that was, you know, working for years and years at the Lakers and just very traditional and now just embracing the technology. So we're proud of that transition that they've made. And when we do get teams to kind of think outside the box and not be so traditional, it's a win-win for all of us. Moving on to the second trend that I'm talking about is the storytelling. And this is so important because what does really storytelling mean? This is a buzzword. We've all heard it. We hear it at all the conferences, everywhere we go. Everyone wants to talk about storytelling. For us, it starts with less copy and more visuals because we learn, obviously, by what we see, not what we hear. We've broken it down, we think, as far as what does storytelling actually, like, how do we break it down? So the first one for us is partner first. Second is the data and the infographics that we can work with. And then multimedia, very rich interactive videos for that. So I'm just going to kind of go through some examples of our partners. We've got many partners. We're just going to show a couple of these, but I wanted to kind of go through that. A lot of people with storytelling, and when we work with all the teams, they're always wanting to start with, you know, about them and about the franchise. And so we thought that the Nuggets KSC partnership was a really good highlight for us to talk about as far as them putting the partner first, their objectives, starting their presentation with that. So as we keep evolving, this is what we're hearing. We just met with the NBA. They're saying the same things. They're like, it all has to be about the partner. Everyone thinks that storytelling is about the franchise, but it really is. How does their story interact with your story? And start with that. So we, here is a, you know, the KSC partnership that we did. This is a deck that we did for them, going through their objectives. This is their objectives. Little bit more about the actual whole interactive partnership that they did. So leading with the partner first is really important. That's what we're trying to instill every day as far as, you know, even when we get the decks. When we start working with the team, they will always send us their deck first, and they're always, you know, it's kind of the main message, like, we love our deck, but we want to be able to do some more things. We want to make it more about the partner, so less about, you know, themselves. Infographics. This is our second one, data. Data is a new currency, as you all know. How do we bring it to life? So what we're trying to do here is we're just trying to take as less copy as we can and helping them sell. The Cubs obviously have a great story to tell. So we've, you know, we got a lot of very heavy copy deck. We just kind of go through, make it more visually enticing, do more of the infographics. As you know, infographics are really the wave of the future here for everything. We can't say enough how people would rather read an infographic. A lot of these are interactive as well. We just, as far as a lot of video that we have in these is coupled with the infographics, but we're not going to be playing the video today on just the GoToMeeting because it's not that great over GoToMeeting for video. And then we go through here, just a couple more infographics just to give you examples. Again, all of these were text heavy. The third, how we break down storytelling for sure is with video, which is the real whole crux of the DigiDeck as far as being able to make it as media rich as we can, and as far as being able to show the in-game experience, show, you know, highlights from the game, whether they're getting interviewed by the coach or the GM or the owner, all of it is all plays into what we try to instill as far as helping sell the partnerships. So between partner first, the infographics data, just coupling it with video, it really, you know, provides, it's like a home run for a presentation helping obviously gain sponsors and partners. If you can obviously give the whole experience via the video, makes such a bigger difference for us and when selling, and with the industry that we work in sports and just like with NASCAR and all that, as far as the excitement of being there, this is a pregame experience that we help with the Red Sox. A little bit here more, we give the presentations and help with them to interact. You can actually click and interact with the actual, you know, being in a suite and what to do. All of this is helping sell the partnerships. You're just not, you're bringing everything to life. Through the video, we do 360 panels, so we'll go through and we will sit, and during the game day, we will shoot game day. We will shoot premium areas. This is a great partner of ours, the Minnesota Twins. They have done a great job with their DigiDeck. They're very progressive in what they do. They had a new area this last year, the catch, and so they had a lot of 360 video or panels, things like this. This is all video work here during game, after game, pregame. Here's an example of something that we've done for the Mets. Just another way of being interactive, showing partners the potential of how their brand looks within the stadium. And of course, I know that it's just not all about the logos and the dasher boards or the outfield signage and things like that, but for them, part of the activations and things do include this, so it's nice to show them in a way of just not being able to be on a piece of paper. So between, you know, providing your partner first in your, you know, your pitches, including as much infographics, less copy, and as much video as you can do is really what we see as the real winners as far as, you know, securing partnerships and helping in your pitches, making you feel comfortable when you're there and being able to showcase your experience with your franchise. This is something that we worked with the Boston Red Sox. They actually interviewed their, you know, club members, which was great. I think if you're a prospective club member, there's no better thing that, you know, better than a testimonial or a video testimonial. And this is a great piece that they use to obviously sell that area. This is a great use of their video. Here, just a little bit more. This also includes it's a video pitch from the Nuggets coach, just giving them a little insight on how that works. Here we did a project for the Dallas Mavs, and this is when Mark Cuban did about 4 or 5 takes. They were pretty funny, a little bit of a bloopers, but he actually was pitching for their premium seats as far as being able to take a trip out to California. But so we sent this out, and I mean, how valuable is it to have Mark Cuban having a direct message to you as far as, you know, renewing early, being part of this trip? Here again, just another video. If you can see down in the bottom left-hand corner, everything with the partnerships and the DigiDeck includes video. Here's an example that we did with the Dallas Stars. They did player thank yous, which I thought was great. As far as doing recaps at the end of the season, after we give them an interactive recap, they had all their, you know, top players say thank yous to their corporate sponsors, which was great. This was sent out to all of their partners. And then obviously another thank you, just video thank you. This can typically come from the coach, the GM, or the owner, which is nice. So just really trying to drill down as far as what does that storytelling mean to everybody. I just know we hear it over and over. So for us, we just said, this is what storytelling means to us and how we make that happen, because I feel like it's just such a broad term out there. Okay, so moving on to the third point as far as experience show and what we're thinking as far as this is a huge trend. We've all heard it. At the conferences, again, this is like the three buzzwords that we're working with. This one, we wanted to highlight a partner that we worked with at the National Sports Forum. Some of you, I apologize if you were in the room and have already heard it, but just wanted to touch base a little bit about what this was. But this was an amazing partnership between the New York Mets and Coca-Cola. It was a full 360 partnership, a very forward-thinking partnership, highly interactive, and a great use of their digital assets. So a lot of video, so I won't be able to play the video, but just to show you a little bit about what they did in this partnership, but just as far as highlighting what, you know, the experience or the exposure that we've had, this is probably one of our favorites. So as far as this was Noah Syndergaard, they did a nice project with him throughout New York City. They were, it was about a 5-minute video, and he literally just went around the city and talked to New York Mets fans. It was fantastic, highly interactive, obviously blasted out on all social media, got a lot of traction, so just a really good use of digital assets. You know, with that whole full 360 partnership, trying to be able to tie all of the assets that you have, this was a very big push on Coca-Cola's part to actually really push the envelope with the New York Mets. The New York Mets were very, very open to what they wanted to do, and it was almost like the Mets were willing to be a beta type customer for Coca-Cola and what they were doing in that partnership. Just a couple little highlights here. Just the first pitch that they did, that was a huge hit for them. They also had a very cool new interactive addition to the ballpark. This was the Coca-Cola corner, which was armed and with full AR for the fans, which is great. Couple pictures of that. This can be a whole presentation. Obviously, we had a whole session on it, but when I think of experiential, this is really one of the top ones that I think about. Here, just a little bit more about the Coca-Cola engagement with augmented reality. And then obviously tying it back to like the ballpark app, iBeacon, and all that. So all of that coming to life for us as far as just highlighting. So what I tried to do is just really kind of highlight things that we've done with partners that kind of go under the trends that we are seeing out in the marketplace. And obviously, with working with such a wide variety of partners, we are just privy to such great, exposure to so many great ideas and activations and things like that. So it's really our job to make sure that we bring it to life and we help them bring it to life. So we're very proud of that. As far as we have one last case study that I wanted to touch on, I'm going to actually turn it over to Christy Grady, who's our EVP of sales, who was responsible working with the Yankees, which is a great case study. She'll do it really quickly because I know we're short on time.
Yeah, just quickly for me, it's been fun to be a part of these partnerships because I do come from the team side. So getting a different perspective, being on this side and able to kind of take some best practices from those partners that we work with. But initially in sitting down with the Yankees, the big piece for them was they really needed to utilize their digital and visual content to tell that Yankee story, the tradition, the rich history, but also just kind of the modern elements of the Yankees as well. So they came to us to kind of talk about how we could help them do that with the DigiDeck. In addition, they have a ton of fantastic video content just to go off of what Angelina just highlighted. It's how do we make that rich media come to life in an easy manner. They had salespeople that were using old logos or old campaigns, maybe players that weren't on the roster anymore. So again, just how to instill that consistent brand message and shorten their sales cycle by kind of the analytics that come behind our platform. So those were kind of their goals when we sat down to put together a partnership for their DigiDeck. They have a sales DigiDeck with us, and I'm going to go ahead and pull that up quickly to show you guys just some quick snippets. This is just kind of a generic deck that I put together with their permission, of course. So this, the open here is really just kind of highlighting and setting the stage for a meeting, right? And then there, I'm going to skip the video because we are on GoToMeeting. But again, just evoking that emotion in the people in the room before they are giving their overall presentation. And one of the things, just to touch off of Angelina's points, is their storytelling through infographics. Just, again, people know that the Yankees have a rich tradition and history, but how can we see that in infographics and really tell that in a visual manner? And that's kind of, those are some of those slides that I have turned on here for you, just to highlight how they're doing that to showcase the value of partnering with the Yankees brand. This is one of those pieces that I mentioned of just what's present-day Yankees versus kind of that rich tradition and history and that legacy piece versus current information about the Yankees. From a branding perspective, Angelina did mention the panorama. So again, just giving people an opportunity to really interact with the brand. This highlight here is a video piece. But again, this is all automatically populates in their presentation. So the Yankees just found that this helped speed up the process for them and their salespeople to really come up with these custom presentations to provide them to partners and reach a broader audience to grow their sponsorship revenues. And finally, just to tie in that experiential piece is, again, with video and their old-timers photo day event that they have. But that's just kind of a quick highlight of how the Yankees really utilize the Digidex platform. This is obviously a condensed version of a proposal, but wanted to just make sure that I pulled that up for you guys here today. Any questions for Angelina and I?
No, I know that we will, people that will be writing them in, and we'll send them to you. But I have a question, and that is, if we could, and thank you so much, Christy, and thank you so much, Angelina, how would somebody get in touch with you? How, your website URL, phone number, contact information, if they were interested in getting more information about it and talking to you guys about this?
Yeah, I mean, just go into our website, or our emails are really easy. It's cgrady@sportsdigita.com or alawton@sportsdigita.com. So pretty simple to write that one down. And we also will be sending out a quick snippet of our presentation through you all to the participants on the call. So
excellent. And if anybody has any questions specifically and you want to write them in even after the call to Albie and Ashley, we'll make sure that we route them over to Christy and to Angelina for that so that you can get information on that. But that's just outstanding. For those of you, and Angelina didn't really do justice to it, but that breakout session that they did with the Mets at the Forum last month was just incredible. And our thanks, obviously, to Coca-Cola and the Mets for being there to kind of walk everybody through it. And they'd be the first ones to tell you that they owe a huge debt of gratitude, obviously, to Sports Digita for that. So, guys, thank you so much, and certainly thank you for your involvement with the Forum. And we are going to turn to our cleanup hitter, if we could, here for a second. And certainly it is my pleasure to introduce really, truly one of the most innovative, when you talk about outside-the-box thinkers, in Dan Magala, who is officially the Chief Innovation Officer for PCG Sports Desk Media. But many of you might know Dan, I mean, for years. Back in 2002, he started publishing the Magala Report. And that might have been your first introduction to him. I think his first forum was back in 1999. He's 18 years an NSF alum, and I draw from him all the time, always putting him to work. He did a special workshop for us that was extremely well attended last month in the Innovation Lab, which I'm hoping we can convince him and Brian Gaynor, his partner in crime on that, to continue that next year because it was so well received. Dan is a 13-year member of the steering committee, and one of the things that I love is that he has either worked for or advised virtually every level of sports that you're going to find out there, from Major League Baseball to Minor League Baseball, NFL, NBA, NCAA, MLS, LPGA, and more internationally. I get a lot of information from Dan about Cricket Australia, certainly all kinds of different avenues that involve non-traditional revenue generation, sponsorship, technology, sports marketing, and all points in between. PCG has really come out there and become a very, very much a very valuable resource to us all in the sports industry, and certainly one of the most innovative outside-the-box thinkers. We asked Dan, as we're kind of taking everybody through the process of sponsorship, you know, Angelina talking about helping us to sell it, and in Dan's case, of course, it's not about the sale, it's about the resale. In order to do that, it's the activation and ways that we're doing a great job of keeping that sponsor engaged to the point where they'd be crazy to drop the sponsorship when it's over. So a lot of organizations, a lot of clubs call on Dan and his group to come in and help create some really unique properties and programs around their particular sponsors and their property. So Dan, I'm gonna put you on the hot seat if I could, and really talking about innovation and activation. And with that said, take it away.
Yeah, well, thanks. Thanks for the kind introduction, Ron. It's great to follow Angelina, Christy, and Chad in the triple threat here today. But what I wanted everybody to do, and actually by design, I don't have any slides today. And one of the reasons is I want everybody to get in that mindset of the virtual blank canvas. Which I think is the hardest part sometimes of the sponsorship. We've all felt it, whether we're Chad or the wonderful partners that Sports Digita has, or our own clients of, you're stuck for that idea, right? And what do you do? And we're really fortunate in our portfolio of partners. We've really got, I think, three groups that I put you in the mindset of. We've got a couple current world champions in the Chicago Cubs. As a Chicago guy, it's not too often I get to say world champion Chicago Cubs, so round of applause for any of the Chicagoans listening. The Cleveland Cavaliers and Hendrick Motorsports, right, which are at the top of their game, you know, on the field. We've got a unique portfolio of about 45 college athletic departments and universities at various levels of their life cycle. And then we've got two unique properties in Feld Entertainment and Minor League Baseball, where I'd say the fans really are the stars. And when you're tasked at that first moment, whether you've got an idea for a brand to go after or you have a great meeting, what do you do with that first moment of truth, if you will, that blank canvas? And what we like to say is we like to slow things down to speed it up. And what we do is we start first of with our core objective. Sponsorship makes the things consumers love happen. And what is it that consumers love about this team? So you saw that with the Yankees. You saw that with the passion of NASCAR. And then we start to build a model. And I'm going to walk you through a real-time case study of the process of being in the room where we start to think, and this is actually, Chad said it really eloquently, your best friend is the CFO in your organization. And sometimes we like to lead almost unintentionally with the dollars. How much money are we going to make off of this? But we like to get in the discipline of revenue is a result, not an objective. So if we believe that this sponsorship is going to make that fan passion grow and evolve, we can design a revenue platform on there. So our process is really rooted in four things. Stand for something, take a risk, tell a story, and own a moment in time. And I think the team at Sports Digita said it very well. You know, we're in this era of digital, and that own a moment in time of how you tell the partner story through the digital and social platforms becomes very critical to it. So let me just repeat that. Stand for something, take a risk, tell a story, own a moment in time. And we were challenged, actually, by Len Komorowski, who's the great longtime friend of the forum, former steering committee member, who's now the chief executive officer for the Cleveland Cavaliers. And he challenged us to design a new seven-figure sponsorship opportunity. But then he challenged us with the storytelling challenge of not essentially going to you know, the traditional hallmarks that you have, LeBron, championship level team. How do we find a unique sales proposition about the Cavs? And what we realized is we thought like a brand. We used that process and that stand for something. We learned two of the 12 players from the Cavaliers were actually born in Australia. So that's a new storytelling opportunity. So our stand for something in this virtual blank canvas started with how do we position the Cavs in a sponsorship marketplace as Australia's NBA team. The second part about it, which was the take a risk, we started to understand, you know, that sponsors love owning a customized idea, again, that their investment made possible. So the risk was the two players, Kyrie Irving, you know, an elite all-star level player, and then they also had a guy, Matthew Dellavedova, who was born in Australia. Kyrie and Delly were both born in Australia. And we took a risk and we really focused on, and I think this is something that teams and properties could really do a wonderful job around, the simplicity of the storytelling around those assets that they have. Matthew Dellavedova is a guy at the time making the league minimum salary who actually drove like a used Mazda, right? He's basically like your little brother if he made the NBA. But what we thought, there was some grit, there was some storytelling opportunities to be able to build something around it. And what our idea started to focus on, so what is the ownable asset? Again, sponsorships makes the things we love happen. We knew Australia, the international market, had a passion for Delhi. We knew the blue-collar fan base of Cleveland really kind of felt he was that underdog player. So what do we do with that information? And the where the tell a story came through was we realized that during the season, Independence Day for Australia, their 4th of July, if you will, their Australia Day, falls on January 26th every year. So we pitched the idea and worked with the concept with the NBA. Could we tell the story around the NBA's first ever Australia Day game, play that game on the night of January 25th in Cleveland, which roughly 18 hours ahead would be breakfast time in Australia? And how would we go about doing that? And what we needed to do was a partner to make that happen. So you start with that virtual blank canvas, and now all of a sudden you've got an authentic story to do what? Reach out to an Australian-based business, which is now in what category? Breakfast became a no-brainer. We researched who is the market leader. There's a company called Sanitarium, which I would say is the Kellogg's of Australia. And we worked very methodically to get in front of them, reached out and pitched the idea to be able to do it. And when you've taken that time, again, slow things down to speed it up from a creative process, and you think like a brand and you follow and ultimately, I think, answer that question. If you own that brand and own the team, is this the best idea you could come up with? And we felt yes. They made the investment to it and launched the NBA's first ever Australia Day game. And I think where it all comes together, and this is what's really interesting on a digital activation, and we see this a lot with the colleges that we work with and some of the brands, is your fan relationship is inventory, and digital channels give you the ability to reach and engage 365. And I think Chad even said, the fan watching on the iPad is just as valuable, if not more. And we worked on a very strategic digital media activation to spread the word of this investment. And that own a moment in time for that one day, I think sometimes you can break through the clutter a lot more and own a day. We had a great program with Minor League Baseball a couple years ago on a home run derby that we did with an aircraft carrier that went viral. And the whole concept was owning one day nationally for the baseball fan. And I think the results of it, and I think this is a great aspiration, it became the number one trending social media topic in the country of Australia on their national holiday. So stop and think about that aspiration, that stand for something. Australia's NBA team, there was an authentic goal. Sponsor was the one that made it happen. We rallied around kind of the underdog story versus, maybe the one that was more obvious. And we achieved that goal of own a moment in time. And it's a good reminder, and I'll leave you guys with this and sensitive to leave time for questions. It's a great reminder for the Cavs on the NBA level as a world champion or any property that's on this call that brands invest in customized solutions that solve their business problems and allow them to seem bigger than they really are. And my last takeaway on this, think about this. That breakfast cereal that was the title sponsor, seven-figure investment to the Cavaliers, that product is not even sold in the United States. And that to us is a really great eye-opener when you think outside the box, you think outside your geographic limitations, you think outside the budget, and what you can do if you really follow that virtual blank canvas and think about what your organization stands for beyond the X's and O's of what your team or league or governing body does. What are risks that you can do in terms of ideas and innovation? How do you tell your story in an authentic way that's aligned with the partner's story? And then I think if you're very strategic and almost a surgical approach, own a moment in time and be ready to use all your digital media, activation to own that moment in time. I think there's a lot of challenger brands. There's a lot of maybe non-traditional, and I think Chad said it best too. There's not a lot of heads of sports marketing, and I think brands that are really looking for that type of investment, brands invest in customized solutions, and I think this was a wonderful learning process for us. that has worked not only at those world championship team levels, the college and university, but minor league baseball and Feld that are entertainment properties. There's some universal truths there. So I'm gonna transfer the virtual blank canvas back to Ron from some of those talking points. But a good reminder, I think, for everybody, when you're stuck in that moment, slow it down to speed it up. And I think you can simplify it with the right process of following some of the lessons from the Cavaliers and what we learned with their Australia Day.
Thank you so much, Dan. A really great presentation and an outstanding program. That Australia Day program was one of the top six SAMMY programs, which is our annual award presented and really selected by the attendees at the forum. But we present six just outstanding ideas that we run into every year. And the Australia Day program was one of them, and really just terrific. He just touched on some of the points, and like I said, you guys, just really, really innovative. But Dan, a question for you. I know the market, we hear this a lot, you know, at the forum about the evolving market, how it's changing. Angelina talked about it with millennials and her research. Chad touched on it with the new direction that, that NASCAR is going. Are activation trends changing now? Do you see that happening, the landscape, say, 5 years ago, but now as we start gearing up for this next generation, the millennials that they talk about, is that changing the way that you guys are building your programs out?
Absolutely. We like to say that the best asset a team or a league has, it's a relationship with its fans. And what we've done is use digital to allow them to reach a message on any device at any time in a customized way. So by creating a digital fan network, you know, the ability for a brand to activate 365 with a push of a button to follow that fan anywhere they go, regardless of on if they're on club or team.com, we learned is a great way to help a brand advance their message, sell their product. You know, you pause and you think about it. One of the challenges for a brand of any of the teams or leagues that we've talked about on this call, their product and service, they need to sell to fans of that team even when the team isn't playing. And I think digital allows you a more unique way to be able to do that. And tap into a different budget. The millennial question, Ron, we've had the great benefit over the last year, our team in Dallas and a group of analysts and digital media planners have worked on probably one of the preeminent millennial brands, really even on the world right now, in Topgolf, of reaching an acquisition strategy and a target for them. And I think that's a wonderful case study for a lot of the teams and properties that are on here of how do they use their marketing, their activation dollars to basically communicate in the most customized, segmented way where there's no real dead weight to the message. And I think, you know, look at what millennial brands are doing very well and how could you translate to the business objectives of your organization.
I mean, you hear it time and time again, especially with this next generation coming in. It's about the experience. And I think we saw that with the Mets program with Coca-Cola, you know, how much of that was built around the engagement and the experience, which really seems to be, preeminent with this next generation coming in. And, boy, I hate like heck to say this, but I got to call it, you guys. We've reached the top of the hour, and I know there's probably a number of questions that many of you have. Certainly, if you want to reach out to any three of our presenters today, just go ahead and send an email over to Albie, and he'll get it out to these people, and certainly they'll be happy to answer questions or to get in touch with you. But I just want to take this opportunity, certainly, to thank Chad Siegler and certainly congratulate him for all the great work that his team is doing with Monster and all of their properties that they're doing at NASCAR. And certainly thank Angelina Lawton for being involved and engaged with us with the Digideck and at Sports Digita, and certainly wish them continued great success. And of course, to my old friend Dan Magala from PCG and Sports Desk Media, just a terrific, terrific job. And we thank you all for being part of this month's webinar. We look forward to engaging with everybody. And like I said, by all means, if you haven't yet, feel free to sign up for Selling It. It's a biweekly e-zine that we put out. It's sponsored by Sports Digita. And we send it out to everybody every other Wednesday with a different idea, like a program like the Cavs Australia Day. We'll do a deep dive into that, and you'll get a chance to find more information about it. And it's just our pleasure to be able to put that out all throughout the year to give everybody new ideas and new insights and hopefully turn the light bulb on for everybody. So with that said, I just want to thank again Chad, Angelina, and Dan for being with us, and I want to thank all of you for taking the time out today to join us on the NSF webinar. We will talk to you soon, everybody. Take care now. Bye-bye.